Hi viewers, good morning. Myself Arvind Gopal, Assistant Professor of Physics, and I am working at Government Degree College Mahabad District and Telangana. Today we are going to discuss about electrostatics unit, that is unit 1 in the course of electromagnetism, which is a curriculum for BSc third year fifth semester students. So before going to the lecture, let us discuss what we have learned in the earlier lecture. In the earlier lecture we learned a few things, that they are like what you mean by electric field. We have discussed electric field. Electric field is nothing but the area surrounded by a charge or group of charges in which we bring a unit positive charge from infinity to that particular place. Like this, let us say we have group of charges for the time being. Let us take positive charge here. It is a group of charges Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q4 and Q5 are there. Due to this positive charge, in surroundings one electric field will be generated. So suppose this is our unit positive charge. If you are bringing this unit positive charge from infinity to this particular point, wherever it is we want to bring the electric field, there on this particular positive charge depends on whether it is positive or negative, a electric force, repulsive force or attractive force will be acting on this unit positive charge. So we define the electric field as a region, this region which is surrounded by a group of charges or a single charge, in which if other positive charge comes into the region, if it experiences a force, that force we are calling it as electric field. But the thing is that this electric field intensity is force per unit charge. But here we are taking unit positive charge, right? That's why what happens, the electric field is equal to the force when we take this is a unit positive charge. And one more thing we have discussed in that class, that is we have discussed the electric field and electric potential, the relation between them. If you know the electric field and electric potential, the relation we can write like this: E is equal to minus del del V, where this is the del operator. The del operator is written as I dou by dou x plus j dou by dou y plus k dou by dou z. Here I, j, k and r unit vectors in x, y, z directions respectively. And we have also discussed the Coulomb's law. We have also discussed about Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law tests as, let us say we have two charges, one is Q1, the other is one is Q2. If they are unlike charges, that means this is positive, this is negative, between them an attractive force will be there. If they are like charges, like this is Q1 is positive and Q2 also positive, then between them a repulsive force will be there. So the force of attraction or repulsion between these two forces, between these two charges Q1 and Q2, is given by, we write the force as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 divided by r square. This is called as Coulomb's law. So these things we have discussed in the earlier class. So what we have discussed in the earlier class? We have discussed the what is electric field and what is the relation between electric field and electric flux, sorry, electric field and electric potential, and we have also discussed about the Coulomb's law. So in the last class we have calculated the electric field due to a point charge by using this Coulomb's law. That is also we have discussed. In today's class what we are going to learn is, we are going to learn about the electric field lines and the properties of electric field lines. So electric field lines are nothing but the force lines, electric field force lines, we'll discuss later. And we are going to discuss about the electric flux also. What is meant by electric flux, how to calculate the particular surfaces also we are going to discuss. And Gauss law in integral form we are going to discuss. And we are also going to prove the Gauss law. We are also going to prove the Gauss law using Coulomb's law. These are the things we are going to discuss. So let us define electric field line. An electric field line is the imaginary smooth curve drawn in electric field along which a pre-isolated positive charge will move. So let us say this is positive charge. Okay, in the surroundings there is electric field. Let us say we are bringing one unit positive charge from this place to this place, or let us say we are keeping a positive charge in this place. Because this is also positive, this is also positive charge, because of the repulsion force, this charge moves away from this positive charge in straight line. So this is nothing but the path of moving of a unit positive charge away from this positive charge is called as electric field lines. So for positive charge, the electric field lines will be away from the center like this. For positive charge, the electric lines of force will be away from the center. Otherwise, if you take a negative charge, if you bring a positive charge from some place to towards the negative charge, it attracts, and that unit positive charge moves near to this negative charge. That's why the electric field lines always directed to inwards for negative charge. So the electric lines of force are the imaginary smooth curves drawn in electric field along which a pre-isolated positive charge moves. Okay, so these are the electric field lines. So this is negative charge. So let us say we have we are having a particular electric field line like this. Okay, so if you know this electric field line at a particular point, if we draw a tangent at this particular point, then we came to know the direction of the electric field. This tangent gives the direction of electric field, and the path of the pre-positive charge in an electric field is called electric field line. So I have already explained here. So the path of the pre-positive charge in an electric field is called as electric field line. So we can represent the electric field lines by the electric lines of force. So suppose this is a charge, let us say this is a charge. Okay, the electric field lines are like this for a positive charge, that means away from the center of the charge. So if you consider a unit surface area, okay, this is unit surface area. Let us call this one as a bar, and in this surface, let us say at this particular point the electric field intensity is E bar. Then the electric plus is given by phi is equal to E bar dot A bar. So this is the electric flux. So the number of electric lines which are passing through a unit area is called as electric flux. So now let us consider this diagram. If you consider this diagram, this is the positive charge. This is the positive charge. Okay. So as we have discussed earlier, the electric field lines are away from the positive charge. So if we bring a unit positive charge into this field of a positive charge, the electric the positive charge move away from the positive charge. So for positive charge, the electric lines of force will be directed away from the center of the positive charge. In other way around, if we bring a unit positive charge into the electric field of our negative charge, the electric field lines the positive charge will be attracted towards the negative charge. That's why the electric field lines are towards the positive charge. So this is the difference. So the electric lines of force for positive charge are away from the center of the positive charge, whereas the electric lines of force for negative charge are towards the center of the negative charge. So if you consider a particular surface unit normal, that means very small area perpendicular to this lines of force, let us call that is ds bar. Then the electric flux which is passing through this surface is defined as E bar dot ds bar. This we are calling it as d pi. That means the flux passing through this small area, d pi is equal to E bar dot ds bar. Here one thing we have to remember, that is, if the electric field lines of force are passing through the surface, then the flux is negative. Flux is negative. But if the electric field lines are going out of the surface, then the flux is considered as positive. So this is the notation for flux. Till now we have discussed about the electric field lines for either positive charge or negative charge. Now let us discuss about the situation when unlike charges are placed together. That means equal and opposite charges placed together in a area. Then how the electric field lines will be there, and when the equal and opposite charges are like charges are placed in the area, in the space, how the electric field lines are will be there. So just consider this this case. Here this is the positive charge, this is the negative charge. As we have discussed, if we keep a unit positive charge somewhere here, it moves away because of this is negative, this is positive charge. This unit positive charge gets repulsion from positive charge. So it moves in this direction. As it comes to this position, the force of attraction and force of repulsion will be almost equal. So it gets attracted towards this positive charge. So electric field lines line will be like this. And if you are moving in this path, so like electric field lines will be like this. So for a positive and negative combination, the electric field lines are like this. So in another case, if we consider a both of them as positive charges. Let us bring one positive charge from somewhere in between to at this particular point. If we consider both of them are equal equal charges, the here this is charge is away from that means at a long distance from this charge. That means the force of repulsion on this unit positive charge from this charge will be less, but the force of repulsion on this unit positive charge from this charge is will be more. That's why what happens, it moves in this direction. So it comes to this position. Okay, at this position what happens, the force of attraction from this force of repulsion from this charge is from this charge on this unit positive charge, let us say that is F1, and the force of repulsion because of Q2 charge on this positive charge, let us say that force is F2. At this particular position, let us say they are equal and opposite, equal charges, that means equal charges and like charges, then what happens, F1 becomes F2. That means at this particular position, there is no net force acting on the particle. That's why this particular position is called as null point. That means on this particular position, there is no net force, but force will be there, but there is no net force on that particular charge. So if you plot electric field lines, the electric field lines for this particular combination will be like this. Okay. Next, let us discuss about the properties of electric field lines. The tangent drawn at any point on the line of force gives the direction of electric field at that particular point. This we have already discussed. Suppose this is the electric field line of force. If we plot a tangent to this electric field line at this particular position, then the direction of the electric field at this position will be in this direction. So this is the first point. The electric lines of force start from positive charge and end at negative charge. We have discussed already this one in the previous slide. Here the electric field lines are electric field lines start from positive charge and end at negative charge. No two lines of force intersect each other. This is a very important point. Actually, if the two lines, suppose this is one electric field line, let us say this is one more electric field line, if they intersect, what happens at this particular position, the electric field will be having two directions. That means single electric field will be having two directions. That is not at all possible. So no two lines of force intersect each other. That's why this is the condition. The number of lines of force crossing unit area in normal direction is proportional to the electric field intensity. So let us say this is our uniform electric field. Okay, so if we consider a unit normal to this electric field, the number of lines crossing for unit area in normal direction is proportional to the electric field intensity. So from this we can calculate the flux, from flux we can calculate the electric field intensity. Okay, the lines of force have a tendency to contract in length. This explains the attractive force, because let us say if you take a positive charge, positive charge electric field lines will be outward. If we consider it in this particular place, the electric field lines intensity is more. That means the lines of force having tendency to contract in length, this explains the attraction. That means here either otherwise you consider this negative charge. For this negative charge, the electric field lines will be into this negative charge. So if you consider this particular point, if the electric field lines are more, then it explains the attractive force, attraction between this charge and a positive charge, unit positive charge. The lines of force have a tendency to separate from each other in direction perpendicular to their lengths. This explains the repulsion. This is the case. The lines of force are perpendicular to conducting surfaces at points close to them. They are perpendicular to the equipotential surfaces. So, equipotential surface means, let us say, this is the positive charge. If you draw a circle, surrounding this positive charge, on this particular circle and at each and every point, the potential will be same. This kind of surfaces, like there will be many number of like this. This kind of surfaces are called as equipotential surfaces. So the lines of force are perpendicular to the conducting surfaces at points close to them. Now let us define our electric flux. So the electric flux through the surface placed inside electric field represents the total number of electric field lines of force crossing the surface in a direction normal to the surface. So electric flux is nothing but electric field lines crossing the surface. Suppose let us say this is our surface. Electric field lines crossing the surface in a direction normal to the surface. Let us say this is the surface which is normal to this one. So the number of electric lines passing through this unit area is called as electric flux. Now consider this surface, electric flux for closure surface. Here this is a closure surface. This is a closure surface. Just observe this one. This is a closure surface. This one, this entire part. So what we are doing? We are going to calculate the net flux through the surface. That means, just observe, this is a uniform electric field. That means here, everywhere the electric field is same. That's why we are calling it as uniform electric field. So what we are doing, we have brought a surface, a closed surface into this particular electric field. Okay, so now we are going to calculate the net flux through the surface. Okay, so the net flux to the surface through the surface is proportional to the number of lines leaving the surface minus the number of lines entering the surface. So we have already discussed about this notation. Let me explain once more. Here just observe the surface. This particular surface, let us call it as A. This total surface is divided into so many number of small surface areas. Each of the surface area, each of them very small surface area, let us call it as dA surface area. So within that particular surface area, what happens, the electric field intensity will be almost uniform. Okay, so now the electric field lines which are entering into this particular surface, are taken as negative. Electric field lines which are going into the surface are taken as negative. The electric field lines which are emerging out of the surface are taken as positive. So in this particular case, we can consider different positions. If you consider this this particular position, this position, in this position, what happens? Our area vector, aerial vector. How to calculate aerial vector? Let us say this is our surface. This is our surface. Okay. So the direction of the surface is always mentioned by a vector, which is perpendicular to this particular surface. So the direction of this surface is always represented by a unit vector, which is normal to the surface. Okay, just remember. So if you consider the surface, how in which direction that normal is there? In this direction, that is represented here. Okay, so but the electric field is in this direction, because the electric field lines are going in this direction. So the electric field is in this direction, and the aerial vector, that is delta A4, delta A1 is in this direction. This is the angle between those two vectors. This is aerial vector delta A1. This is the electric field vector UE. And this is the angle between, that is pi angle between these two vectors. If we consider this portion, here we are considering this element. But the aerial vector is outward like this, and the electric field lines are, electric field is in this direction. So they are exactly perpendicular to each other. Next, let us consider this particular surface here, this small one. Here, the aerial vector is in this direction, and electric field is in this direction. So, obviously, there is a angle between them is theta. This is greater than 90 degrees. So, the total flux, how we are going to calculate is, like this, we divide this closer surface into many surfaces. So, by using this formula, that is pi e is equal to surface integral over a closer path, e bar dot e da bar is equal to surface integral over a closer path, e and da. So, by using this equation, we can calculate the net flux passing through. This closer surface. Now let us try to find out the flux through a particular surface which is oriented at one particular angle to this electric field. So in this case, the scalar product of electric field vector E bar and surface vector delta S is defined as the electric flux for that particular surface. So this is our electric field. So we have taken uniform electric field. That means electric field intensity at each and every point is uniform or same. So we have taken one surface. This surface we have taken this particular surface. Okay. We have taken this particular surface. So the normal to this particular surface is in this direction. So this is our aerial vector, and but the electric field is in this direction. So the angle between them is theta. So the flux through this particular surface pi is equal to E into magnitude wise E into A cos theta it becomes. Because this is nothing but pi is equal to E bar dot A bar. But A bar is the angle between them is theta, right? That's why this dot product we can write like this, E A cos theta in the terms of magnitude. So the total flux pi E through the entire surface is given by pi E is equal to closed integral over a closed surface, E bar dot S bar is equal to E dot, here we will write one more step, let us say, here from this one. Because E is constant throughout the surface, right? That's why this is a constant, we are taking it out. So, E integral over a closed path, delta S. But this delta S is nothing but the total area surface, that is nothing but our S or A here. So, therefore, phi is equal to integral over a closed path, surface integral over a closed path, E ds cos theta it becomes. But we are bringing this cos theta outside because for particular orientation, cos theta also a constant. So, we are bringing it out. So, this electric flux, so this electric flux pi E is equal to E cos theta integration over closed path, closed surface and ds. So, this is nothing but A. That's why the electric flux phi is equal to E A cos theta it becomes. So, this is the equation for electric flux. Now, let us consider one more surface within which there is no positive charge and negative charge. That means there is no charge within that surface. In that case, what happens? Consider the lines of force of two equal and opposite charges. Okay. The flux is negative for the surface S1. Here, we have two surfaces, let us say. This is one surface and this is one more surface, let us say. Okay. So, the flux is negative for the surface S1. This is surface S1. This, let us say this is surface S2. The flux is negative for the surface S1 and it is positive for surface S2. As we have discussed earlier, the flux entering into the surface is taken as negative and the flux leaving from the surface is taken as negative. That's why here the electric lines of force are leaving from S2 and here the electric field lines are entering into the surface S1. That's why this flux is taken as negative, this flux is taken as positive. The total flux is zero. This shows that there is no charge inside the surface. But here, remember one thing. From this surface, two electric lines of force are entering. But from this surface also, two electric lines of force are leaving. That's why the net flux will be zero. That means if there is no charge inside this particular surface, then the net flux through that surface, net flux means inward flux minus outward flux minus inward flux, that will be equal to zero. Just we have to remember this one. Now, let us calculate the electric flux for this particular combination. Here, this is a cylindrical surface. This is a cylindrical surface. It is having this surface, that is we are taking it as ds1, and this surface, this flat surface, one more flat surface, we are taking it as ds2, or this is ds1, this is ds2, but the thing is that they are equal, and we are taking one more surface. This is surface, curved surface, which is a cylindrical surface. So the electric field is in this direction. Let us say the electric field is in this direction. Okay. So, now let us calculate the electric flux through this surface. For this one, what we have to do? Consider a cylindrical surface of radius r. We are taking this radius as r. In a uniform electric field, E parallel to this surface, the flux phi for the entire cylinder is the sum of fluxes through left face, right face and the cylindrical surface. Here, this is the left face, this is the right face, this is the cylindrical surface. Just consider here, we have already discussed what is meant by flux. Flux is nothing but surface integral over a closed path or closed surface, E bar dot ds bar. Okay. So this can be written as, because here E is a constant, right? So we can take it out, but the thing is that this can be written as E ds cos theta. Here theta plays an important role. So for this particular surface, just consider this surface. For this particular surface, the we have taken a small element on this particular surface. For that particular small surface, the aerial vector is in ds bar is in this direction, but the electric field vector is in this direction, opposite direction. That means the angle between ds one or ds and E bar, electric field for surface 1 is 180 degrees. That means cos theta is cos 180 degrees is almost minus 1. So this is for flux for this particular surface is let us say minus phi 1. If you consider this particular surface, the flux is E ds cos theta. Here theta is 0, that's why it becomes EDS, which is nothing but phi 2. But the thing is that the surface area is equal, right? That's why these two things cancels out. The only thing that is remaining is because of this curved surface. So the net flux through this cylindrical surface is phi is equal to surface integral over a closed path E bar ds is equal to for this one, this is A, this is B surface. For A surface, E bar dot ds bar plus surface integral over the closed path or for the surface E bar dot ds bar plus for this curved path, that is cylindrical path. But as I have explained, these two things cancels out, and the only thing that is remaining is this curved surface. Okay. So for this curved surface, we have to calculate the electric flux. So the flux through this entire surface will be zero. Let us see, because just consider this this surface, which is a curved surface. On this curved surface, the electric field is in this particular direction, but the aerial vector is in this direction. That means the angle between them is 90 degrees. But we know that cos 90 degrees is 0. That's why for this curved surface also the electric flux is 0. So just I am repeating once more, just observe here. For this surface, electric field will be there. For this particular surface also, electric flux will be there. But they are equal and opposite. That's why they cancel out. But for this particular curved surface, the angle between E bar and ds bar is 90 degrees. That's why cos 90 degrees it becomes 0. That's why there won't be any electric flux. So the net electric flux throughout this surface, that means entire surface, is 0. So this is Gauss law. Gauss law states that the total normal electric flux over a closed surface is 1 by epsilon naught times the total charge Q enclosed within the surface. So this is the statement of Gauss law. It can be written as mathematically as phi of E is equal to integral over a closed path E bar dot ds bar is equal to integral over a closed path E ds cos theta. We can write this one because this is a scalar product. We can write like this, is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times Q by Q times, or we can write like this, integral over a closed path E bar dot ds bar is equal to simply Q by epsilon naught. This is the mathematical statement of our Gauss law, where epsilon naught is the permittivity of the free space. Suppose if you want to apply the Gauss law in medium, then this epsilon naught has to be replaced with epsilon. Now let us prove the Gauss law a little bit fast. this is a closed path, a closed surface. Within that closed surface, a charge plus Q is enclosed. So we have taken a small surface on this closed surface. We are calling that area as ds bar. Now we are calling the solid angle made by this particular ds bar element at the center of this charge, at the charge, this angle we are calling it as three dimensional angle, calling it as d omega, that is solid angle subtended by this ds bar at this O. And we are taking the normal to this particular surface, that is ds bar. So this is the normal. So our electric field is in this direction. Our normal to the surface is in this direction. The angle between them is theta. Just now let us go to this definition of this derivation. The electric flux d pi outward through this area ds is given by d pi is equal to e dot ds, that is equal to e ds cos theta, where theta is the angle between e and ds. From Coulomb's law, the electric intensity is equal to e at point P, which is at a distance r. From the point charge, Q is given by E bar is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R square. This is from Coulomb's law. Let us call it this equation as 1. This is equation as 2. From 1 to we can write d pi E is equal to, this is d pi E is equal to, we are substituting, instead of E, we are substituting this term here. So we'll come to this one. Just rearranging the terms, we can write q by 4 pi epsilon naught into ds cos theta divided by r square, but ds cos theta by r square is nothing but solid angle. Solid angle substituted by that surface element what we have taken, that is d omega. So, but ds cos theta by r square is equal to d omega. This is the solid angle substituted by ds at O. Now we can write this d pi li as q by 4 pi epsilon naught d omega. Now we have to find out the total electric flux through entire surface, and it is given by integrating if you integrate this one, we will get the total electric flux through the surface. So this is integral over a closed path, d pi is equal to q by 4 pi epsilon naught integral of d omega, but integral of d omega is nothing but the total solid angle. This is nothing but 4 pi. Now we are substituting that 4 pi value here. Just if you simplify this one, pi is equal to 1 by epsilon naught q comes, because here 4 pi 4 pi cancels out, just q by epsilon naught only remaining, that q by epsilon naught we are writing. So what we have done here, we have started with the integral over a closed path, e bar dot ds bar, and we have ended with the q by epsilon naught. So this is the proof of Gauss law. So now we have proven Gauss law for a closed surface which enclosed a charge q. This is the derivation for Gauss law when the charge is reserved outside the closed path. When the charge dq is outside the surface, let a point charge plus q is at the point O outside this closed surface. Now a cone of solid angle d omega from here, just observe, this is point O where our charge is resides. What we have done, we have drawn a cone which sustains a solid angle d omega at q. So this solid angle intersects this closed path at different points. One is P, Q, R, S. Okay, at a P point, it is intersecting a surface ds1, area of ds1. At Q, it is intersecting an area of ds2. At Q, at R, it is intersecting an area ds3. At S, it is intersecting an area ds4. Now, a cone of solid angle dw from O cuts the surface area ds1, ds2, ds3, ds4 at PQRS respectively. The electric flux for an outward normal is positive, while for inward drawn normal is negative. This is common notation. So the total flux through area ds2 and ds4 are positive, whereas for the areas ds1 and ds1 are negative, ds3 are negative. So the electric flux at point P through ds1 is minus q by 4 pi epsilon naught d omega, because d omega is constant for all the surfaces, because solid angle doesn't vary with position, it is constant throughout the surface. So d omega will be constant, but the only the thing is that is changing is minus, because for surfaces ds1 and ds3 the flux is negative, and for ds2 and ds4 flux is positive. The only thing that is changing is this one. So for electric flux at point P through ds1 is minus q by 4 pi epsilon naught d omega, whereas the electric flux at point Q through ds2 is equal to q by 4 pi epsilon naught d omega, and electric flux at R through ds3 is equal to minus q by 4 pi epsilon naught d omega. For electric flux at point S through ds4 is equal to q by 4 pi epsilon naught d omega. So by now the total flux through this entire surface is by adding them all of them, it comes out to be zero. So the total electric flux through this whole surface is zero, right? That's why for any surface, which is not enclosing any charge, the net electric flux should be zero. This is according to this Gauss law. That is E bar dot ds bar is equal to q by epsilon naught, right? Q by epsilon naught. Here q is equal to zero. That means this E should be this electric flux should be zero. So this is the proof of Gauss law for the case where the charge is outside the electric surface, outside the surface. So what we have discussed in today class, we have discussed about what is electric flux and what are the electric field lines, and we have discussed about the Gauss law, its proof in two different cases. One is when the charge is enclosed within the closed surface, and when the charge is not enclosed in the closed surface. When the charge is enclosed within the closed surface, the electric flux is nothing but it is equal to q by epsilon naught, whereas if the electric charge is not enclosed within the surface, the net electric flux becomes zero. That's why there is no charge enclosed within the surface, the net flux becomes zero. So this is the proof of Gauss law. Thank you very much.